Did I turn off your computer?
I have no idea.
Did you say a little prayer? Did you make a donation to watch me work, wishing well?
I did.
All those things. Good job, you guys, and thanks for working on it. I love watching your hands. This is, that is the gesture of WTF, help me, help me. WTF, help me, if you're out there, help me. Yay, so, that was the action, that was the action part of the play. And this is the dialogue part of the play, in which we answer your questions, we take your questions, and we make up answers on the spot, talking about your work and your creative process. And Annika, what is that tweet again? It says, now we are actually here on the interwebs.
It's at Watch Me.
Get up and say it. Dang, what is this, a holiday?
Hey guys, if you're at home watching, we're sorry for the delay, but you can now tweet in your questions to at WatchMeWorkSLP and use the hashtag HowlRound so we can track you on here.
HowlRound.
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 What a beautiful song.
I think somebody already sang that.
And I'm just from Texas, so she talked funny. And so am I. I talk funny too. So we have to always spell out, you know, like howl around. You know, we'll talk about howl around. Yeah, right. Okay. Anyway, so enough of that. Enough jokes about people from faraway places. Anybody have any questions?
Adam.
Yes,
Adam. So I'm working on a novel right now,
great.
And I'm best at like beginning and ends.
Great.
But not the best at like the middle part.
Right.
Yeah, I'm still going and I'm still pushing myself.
Great.
I know not to stop, but
fantastic.
I find that I am start, like, I wonder if I'm starting to kind of lose the drive that like I had in the beginning, just it within the story. So like, what advice would you give to someone where it's, you know, like me, who's looking to kind of push through the middle and like kind of get that drive back into the story?
Yes. So have you ever, where are you from?
Orange County, New York.
Orange County, New York. That's up to the north.
Yes, it's the most north that New Jersey Transit will go.
Fantastic. So you have, do you guys have a yard? Did you have
yes.
a yard growing up? Did
yes.
you have, did your...
I had to mow it, yes.
You had to mow it?
Yes.
Fantastic. Okay. And did you ever see anybody do laundry and hang it outside?
No, we had a washer and dryer.
Okay. But in Texas, see, we didn't have a washer and dryer. And so, but you've seen, like, pictures of people laundry on the line, because that's what you use. So you know if you hang a sheet on the line, you put a clothespin here and a clothespin there, and the middle goes. So you need a, right? So what you can do is you can do that with outlining. I know it's an evil word. People hate it, but I love outlining.
Well, no, I
great. So you have events, right? Do you have your outline on cards?
No, it's I type it on Word.
Great, okay, so what you can do is just, you want to stay active, because sometimes you're like, you start and you have all the energy, yeah! And then it's that middle bit, you know, that needs that clothespin, right? So what you can do is you can take your outline, just for the middle bit, so you don't have to do the beginning, because you're good with that. The end, don't worry about it, just the middle. And you can transfer it to index cards. So you notice how I stood up when I said that? Active, right? Because this is like energy sinking, right? So we're active. So you transfer it to 3x5 index cards, and you can flip them. And you can think about your novel. So before you write your writing period during the day, you can say, okay, I'm writing this scene, and this scene, or this chapter. And it's active, so you can keep the energy into it, right? So it's not just a big Word document, you know? You see what I mean? So you can do that. That's very helpful. So try that, just for like the next chapter or something, and see if it does. If you have to break it down and do like lots of index cards for a chapter, that's fine too. But you want to get it off that big Word document and get it into something that's active and energetic. Okay? Good idea. Anybody else? How you doing, Chris Barlow?
Good.
I'm just singling you out. How is it in the land of Apple and Mac? Chris works at the Genius Bar, do you know? Yeah. I'm sorry, because we're proud of you, that's why. We won't tell where you were, what Genius Bar. Did I say that? No. It's a secret between you, me, and...
done.
Right.
But because the topic and what I'm trying to talk about, it's delicate. I'm just trying to figure out where to start Act Two. Because I'm trying to write about 9/11 and it's delicate. So I have my options. I'm looking at trying to write from the next year or the next 10 years. And now we're heading into year 15 and I'm just, I think I'm trying to figure out how to make it palatable to myself.
Right.
You know, I'm like, is this works for me, but it's trying to make it make sense to other people, you know, because I'm a responder. So I'm trying to write about what we were all doing.
Right.
And there were times where it was funny and we all were like, we're being disrespectful. But then they would all say, you know, we lost this one. I mean, I work with people who were looking for like their father, their brother, their son, you know,
right.
And they were all like, no, he had this kind of sense of humor, he would have found this funny.
Right.
You know, so I'm going from that and I'm trying to honor the memories of the memories and I want to be respectful, you know. I'm just trying to, you know, figure that out. I'm just like, to sit and say I'm writing a comedy about 9/11 is, you know, it's delicate, you know, for a lot of people.
Right.
You know, I think I have to figure out what works for me, and I want it to, you know, be palatable.
Right.
You know, because it's history.
Right.
There's a lot of, I was there that day and nothing.
Uh-huh. Right, and I was there that day and nothing. What do you mean?
A lot of the things that I've watched have been like, here's what happened, and
oh,
it's this day, but I saw this plane, I saw that plane. There's nothing really like 6 months later, you know, there's sort of after the first week, I don't really see anything, you know, out anywhere that's
right.
written about what happened next.
Right.
And where people are a year later and where people
sure.
are. That,
sure.
I think that's... I mean, it's great, but it's kind of like I'm looking for example. You know, I'm looking for something, and I'm just like, all right, you know? And I'm just, I feel like I'm frozen.
Right.
That's the setback of, there's so much, I don't know where to start.
Right. There are a couple things in listening to what you're talking about. Did everybody hear Samantha talking about she's writing a comedy about 9/11, right?
Yeah, I mean, for lack of a better way to speak, yeah.
Great. It's good to start there and start by, if that, as a first responder, you're writing a comedy about 9/11, it's good to say that. That's why I said it in the microphone to, you know, write. Right? Because it's good to say that. Because what I heard in what you're talking about is not just that you're having, you know, that you're stuck and having, you know, frozen, what you said, but the reasons why. You want to write something, but you're also wanting it to be palatable to people. And that's tricky. That's what we call writing over our shoulder. Making sure that all those people, the thousands of people who might come to our play over the course of the next, or it's a play, right? Over the course of the next 80 years, will find it palatable. That's a lot of people you have to check in with. So I suggest you care deeply about them, but don't look at them.
Okay.
And save both your eyes for your work. So that's number one. That's why I said, okay, I'll say again, you're writing a comedy about 9/11. That's you, what you feel, an authentic experience, right? It speaks to your authentic experience, and you're writing that. We're not gonna ask if they like it, okay? We're gonna focus on them by not focusing directly on them, but by focusing on the them that lives in you. You see the difference? So they're cool with it if you can write the thing that's true. Okay? I mean, sure, you know, blah, 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 blah. I'm writing. Okay? So now you had Act One, did you say?
Yes.
Okay, and so Act Two was like, I don't know what to do with Act Two, correct?
In Googling him to say, hey, guess what, I was joking around about all the funny things, and you know, now he's gone, and I'm just, you know, he was very specific, this was one of the firefighters I worked with, and he was very specific about, we have to find what's funny. Like, he was like, we have to laugh every day, because otherwise there's no point in going on, and they've won.
Right.
That was his, you know, so I think I'm just trying to figure out a place to pick up so that it's a complete thought, so that 80 people in 80, you know, in 80 years, it makes sense.
We're not studying
them
at all.
I think for me, it's
for
just,
you.
Yeah.
What's going to work for you?
Yeah.
It sounds like this guy you worked with, this firefighter you worked with, is important to you.
Oh, yeah.
Can you include him in Act 2?
Yeah, it's becoming clear to me that he wants to be in charge of Act 2 as I sit.
Oh, why are
here.
We having a foot?
I think I just needed to say it out loud.
It sounds to me like, right, that he wants to be in charge of Act 2. So let him.
Okay.
There he is, wanting to be in charge of Act 2. And you're going to let him, because he's one of the people who was saying, we need to be able to laugh at this, otherwise, as he said, they win. Okay? So he's the guy who's loudest in your head right now, and you're going to honor him and honor yourself by listening to yourself and writing this thing from your heart. So you're going to be done next week, or what?
I hope so.
All right.
We'll see.
You got a game plan. So
you got
your character,
yeah.
You got your act one, you've got your character, right? And you're going to go with it, and don't be listening to them.
I think I've got to move him into it. He's in a place, I've got to move him to a new place.
Okay, but I would say go forward.
Yeah.
Don't be going back to act one to fix it, but you're going to go forward, right? Anything you need to add to Act 1, put it on a post-it or whatever and stick it in your notebook and get to it later. Okay? Great job. Can't wait. Sounds great. What's the title? Do you have a title? Not yet. Okay.
I'm trying. It changed. But
okay. Okay. We'll be ready. We're finding a title. Good job.
Not yet.
Okay. So far, so good. Good. Good question. Anybody else? Yes. Remind me of your name.
Sheena.
Okay, Sheena. Hey, Sheena. Welcome back.
I
like Sheena. Like this. I'll do this. Okay.
That's my little one. That actually inspired me for a question. There's a act that I'm avoiding,
mm-hmm.
because I don't want it to come across as a victim. So I guess my question is, what would you suggest when you're dealing with a topic
mm-hmm.
that actually happened to you
mm-hmm.
and is a very touchy subject,
mm-hmm.
but I don't want to be the poster child of this incident.
Right.
But it did happen to me, and it happens to a lot of women.
Right.
But I'm trying to find the trick where it's more of an experiential thing.
What does that word mean, experiential? I
could have made it
word.
Up. I don't know.
You
but
make, no, I heard.
Is it
word? I heard people say the word experiential. You, I love movies. What does it mean? I forget the name. Experiential. What does that mean? I mean, you're just.
It's the experience, but
aren't we all connected to the experience?
I Googled it.
Oh, great.
Oh,
okay. Come to the rescue. Yes.
It's involving or based on experience and observation. The experiential learning associated with X.
The experience.
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
so
I mean.
But anyway, but you're trying, so you there's something that you want to write about.
No, I'm going to write about
You're
it.
You're writing about
the
it.
The challenge
okay.
is
yes.
I don't want the topic to come from a victim position. Does that make sense? The topic
yeah,
is
yeah.
rape. Usually when people are rape victims,
right.
it's like, it's an unfortunate thing, but should happen.
Yes.
It's just like the tsunami, should happen.
Right.
So for me, I know that I'm avoiding it because I haven't written it. I mean, I'm writing it, but it's just like, I'm not happy with it.
Right.
So my thing is, how do I like face that challenge? I guess that's not fair to say how do I. What would you suggest?
I thought it's not about my work.
But it's just one of those, like, it happened.
Yeah,
it's unfortunate,
yeah.
But like, how do? I don't think you could come victorious out of it. But it's one of those.
Well, that's interesting. It's interesting, and I don't know Latin or Greek, but I know English. Victim and victorious. It's interesting, right? Vic. And, oh, I know.
Oh, yeah.
amazing. So, but victim and victorious, right? I mean, they're not, they're probably not connected, but they kind of are in my mind. Because they both start with Vic. Well, they both start with Vic. Which is makes, because now I'm interested. I'm interested because you want to write about a subject of rape, did you say that? A subject of rape. And you don't want to just write about it from the victim. Am I hearing it correctly? Right.
But there's a block because I'm not there yet, or I just don't know how to.
It's tricky. There's a couple of things. One, I think we as a culture need to reframe what we think of victims. Because some shit, like the folks who, you know, in Fukushima, I have some friends who lived in Japan, like, they were the victims of some shit that went down.
Right.
I mean, they were the victims. Now, In America, we tend to like hate the victims, hate all the victims, die your victims, so we hate on you, and then no one wants to be the victim, and no one wants to take responsibility. It's really weird, you know. Instead of just saying yes, this happened, so we have to reframe what we feel about victims, like it was her fault. That's what sometimes we feel about them, which is totally bullshit and wrong. Okay, so we don't, or and she'll never be able to do anything else except talk about this. Which is what also we feel about victims, and this is going to define her. So we feel that about victims, and that's all they ever are. And all that is like crap and bullshit, okay? So we need to reframe that first. And then I think once we do that, we can write about being the victim of a crime and not have it be fall into that slot with all these other things. Just like you could say, everything about black people is really like a downer, and it doesn't perform. That's what Hollywood says. Things involving black people don't perform, which means they don't make overseas. Okay, whatever. But it's because it's just not interesting to us. It's not universal. So we need to reframe what's universal and how. We need to reframe a lot of things in order to tell an authentic story, instead of just telling a story that's going to be palatable to the marketplace. Those people. You tell your authentic story, and if it shows that you or that the subject was the victim of a horrible, horrible crime, I think through the authentic telling of it, we all are liberated to a new understanding. Just start talking.
Thank you.
You know what I mean? Just start talking, and if whatever.
It's not
again,
about me. I just want to, like.
Sure. Just start talking. The way you figure out how to talk about it is by talking. The way you figure out Act Two is by jumping in there and going with it. You know what I mean? That's the way. At a certain point, sure, there's research that needs to be done. There's all this stuff that needs to be done. But at a certain point, you need to jump in and flail around until it looks like swimming. You know what I mean? And that's all we ever do anyway. You know, I mean, some people, like Michael Phelps. But then look what happened to him. I mean, he's coming back though, I heard. He's like coming back. He's gonna be in the next one. I mean, he's amazing. Yeah, so. But is that how? Just
no, yeah,
go forward. Survivor. Remind me of your name. Tolu. Hey, Tolu. Okay. Hi.
So, I just started writing, but I'm trying to get over the fact that, like, I think my problem is decision making.
Right.
I have, like, characters and ideas and a plot and more ideas, but nothing really cohesive and together. It's like a lot of everywhere.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I just don't know how to like bring it all into one.
Right.
Because it's all part of the same thing, but it's just.
You just started writing, or you just started writing this new piece that you're writing, and you have a lot of characters and ideas, and story ideas, and interesting characters, and they haven't sort of formed into a thing.
Yeah, like I have some scenes and some.
You have some what?
Some scenes.
So they're forming.
Bit by bit.
Well, that's how it happens.
Sure.
Bit by bit, you know, they kind of, you know. And in I don't know what stage humans we look like fish or something, so it's okay. You keep going, you know? But bit by bit, you just keep adding to what you've got and keep following, you know, like, oh, okay, these two characters are in this scene together and they're doing this. You know, you can talk to your characters, you can say, what are you doing here? What do you want? They're like ghosts. They are. They're like, they're haunting you. And you're like, well, why are you here? What do you want from me? Right? And they'll say, I want to be in a play. You know, why? You know, I want to be in a novel. You know, why? You know what I mean? What can you do? What are you doing here? What do you want? They always want something. Or they wouldn't have shown up. You know? They show up because they want something, then you can help them get it. No? I mean, they want to be in a play, or a novel, or a song, or, you know? So you ask them, and they say, well, I want, you know, a new dress. And that character's going to buy me one. And you say, oh, cool. You know, and you go, oh, am I making shit up, or am I taking dictation? And, you know, either way, it doesn't matter. You know, I was just talking to a friend of mine, and I said, are we in a cell, a padded cell, drooling, or are we really happy today? And he said, makes no difference. And I thought that was really comforting somehow. So I share that with you. So, you know, just keep going forward. Do you have a writing time during the day when you... No? Well, like, what's your favorite time of day? Midday? Yeah, you're like the only person whose favorite time of day is 5 o'clock. Most of us are not gonna sleep. So like now. So 5 o'clock is your favorite time of day. Great. So do you have the ability to make, say, from 5 to 5:30 or 5 to 6 o'clock your writing period every day or pretty much every day? So you can sort of put down whatever it is you're doing and sit down with your laptop or your notebook or whatever and spend 30 minutes a day, that's all you need to do, writing, just noodling, just talking to your characters, you know? They might not have names yet. You can ask them, what's your name, lady in the brown coat? You know what I mean? My name's Sheila. All right, cool. You know? I mean, but see, it's fun, right? It's like fun, because they're like your friends. I know, you know, children, you know, they have imaginary friends. This is, you know, we're grown up, but we have imaginary friends. It's the same thing. Is that helpful? You just keep going and see if they start to turn into a thing, a story or a whatever. What's your name? I forget your name. Jacqueline. Hi, Jacqueline. Welcome back. It's good to see you. What do you think, Chris?
When you get stuck.
Okay.
When you're stuck,
yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
When you're stuck, when you're like, I'm stuck, it's time to outline. I like to outline before I get stuck.
Okay.
So I don't get stuck.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like shit, right? I mean, when's the time to change the litter box? Before the neighbors knock on the door. You know, then the same thing. So you change, so you outline before you get stuck. But so if like outlining, it like makes your heart go,
yeah.
So do it more often.
Okay.
Right. So now, today is great. 3 by 5 cars that I love so much.
I need to get some.
Staples. They're cheap, right? You can get a package of like 1,000.
Yeah.
But you only need probably, you know what?
100,
20, 20, 10, 10, great, 10, 8 actually maybe. In some practices, you can do your whole screenplay with 8. But anyway, go over to Staples and get yourself some blank on both sides or lines on one side if you like colors, whatever you like, you know, keep them small, 3 by 5, right? And start today. And just write down the scenes as you see them. If you don't know the scene, don't worry about it. You know, because you studied screenwriting also? Playwriting over at Camp New York University?
Yeah.
Where everyone is happy. And that's archery or whatever, I don't know. But so you write down your scene. If you don't know what's happening, just skip it. Go on to the next thing. If you only know the beginning and the end, like you, Adam, just write the beginning and the end. And then shake it around in the middle, it will begin to appear. Okay? So outlining. And it's, again, it's not this weird, like I said before, Roman numeral thing. Unless you're Roman. But the Pope. I'm sure the Pope outlines in Roman numerals. But, you know, it's not a Roman numeral thing. It's not like an anally retentive thing. It's not a weird, thing to take the place of creativity. All these people have these weird, fucked up ideas about outlining. It's just a way to, like, hang your laundry on a line without having it sag. And if it's hung well on the line, then it dries better because the wind can blow through it. It's, you know, you just, so, that's all right. Oh, they're doing something behind the camera. They're doing something. But does that make sense? So you're going to go to Staples? Get some cards, start today. You know, write it in pen or pencil, your choice. Pen, you have a pen there, great. And then you can carry them around your pocket or your bag. When you're on the subway, you can flip them and you can see your movie or your play in your head. Oh man, that's great, right? Look at him, no, Toto's going, yeah! And it's fun. Then you're not like stuck and feeling like you're impaled on a cross or some shit. You know, this like, he was like a special thing. Like he didn't do that, but I mean, it's good. Easter's coming. Okay. We're gonna tell you about next week. Anika, what are we doing? Yes, Anika. Anika's gonna tell you about next week.
Hey guys. Okay, so next week we are not having Watch Me Work next week, unfortunately. But
somebody's doing something here.
Because Head of Passes is opening here at the Public. Next Monday, publicity, and they're having their opening night gala, so it's going to be happening up here. So we're going to not be here next week, but we'll be here the week after that, which is April 4th. So we will see you guys back here at 5 o'clock on the second floor of the Public on April 4th.
Thank you. That's all. We can, if you have a question, because we can go and say bye to HowlRound and just keep talking. Okay. So we love you. Peace. Don't vote for you know who. I show your names.
Remind me of your name, because I'm June. Oh, June, that's right. Okay, I got it.
Busting out
all over. That's right. Okay.
Would you like to sing it?
No.
Would you like to sing it? Can you sing Julie? What's that song about Mr. Show?
When I married Mr. Snow.
Oh my God, I have to find it. That sounds awful.